All right, we are underway. So hello, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us. And welcome to this Moodle Academy webinar titled Moodle Offline, Reaching Marginalised Communities. My name is Richard Lefroy, and I'm the Learning and Media Technologist with Moodle Academy. And I'll be introducing this session and hosting the session today. So joining us for today's webinar, we have three presenters. Zola Madison, a Senior Programs Manager at Inclusiv Education. Tina Nasser, EdTech Educational Designer and Project Manager with Inclusiv Education as well. And Maxwell Fundy, Director and Co-Founder of EduTab Africa. So Inclusiv Education supports Save the Children projects in low to middle income countries around the world to reach even the most marginalized communities and provide them with education and professional development training. Thank you so much to Zola, Tina, and Maxwell for being with us today. And I will hand over to you now.
Yeah, so I am Zola Madison, Senior Programs Manager with Inclusiv Education. And we're really excited to be here today to be with Maxwell and to talk about our work in the majority world. I guess I'll start a little bit just before we dig in a little bit more about Inclusiv. We, as our tagline says, we believe that everyone has the right to learn everywhere. And as Richard mentioned, we are working primarily with Save the Children, with Save the Children offices all over the world. But we work with lots of different partners. We partner with international development actors, humanitarians, education institutions, and corporations in low and middle income settings, including Africa, Asia, and the Pacific. And we use our experience in education, technology, and international development and humanitarian settings to bring education and technology together. So over the course of this conversation, we'll be digging into a little bit around digital inclusion. We'll be talking about specifically what we call the ILP box. We'll have a chance to look at a couple of different case studies, and then we'll dig into some of your questions. So feel free throughout the course of the webinar, just as questions come up, be sure to plunk them in there and we'll start collecting those so that we can have a rich discussion afterwards. So I want to talk a little bit about digital inclusion and really what drives what we're doing here at Inclusiv. And I want to talk about what when we say digital inclusion, we're also the sort of flip side of that. What we're talking about is the digital divide. Very recently, the special rapporteur from the UN on the promotion and protection of the right to freedom of opinion and expression wrote that the internet and access to the internet facilitates economic development and the enjoyment of a range of human rights. Marginalized groups in developing states remain trapped in a disadvantaged situation without that access. So while the UN is not yet at a point saying that internet access is a human right, it is acknowledging that access to the internet and technology is a catalyst for the enjoyment of human rights. Which is really critical because I think what we've sometimes see and sometimes, maybe in your own lives, it's easy for us to sometimes take for granted all the technologies that are around us today, how pervasive that is in our lives. And because we use the internet, we use technology tools for a lot of education things, a lot of business things, but also for a lot of entertainment, we occasionally forget how truly fundamental it is for our own advancement. But what we're seeing right now is that 2.9 billion people who do not have access to the internet. Of those 2.9 billion, 96% of them live in majority world countries. And the other component that I want to raise with that is that what that means for those people who are being left out. So recent studies show that right now, 87% of all jobs have some digital component. So for those 2.9 billion people, we have to ask the question, what is their economic opportunity in the future if they cannot access the internet and if they don't have the skills and capability to make those tools work for them? I want to dig in a little bit, you know, when we talk about this divide, I want to also dig into the scale of the problem. And when I'm talking about scale, I'm talking about both breadth and depth of scale. So right now we know that 1.6 children around the world live in a conflict region. And as you can imagine, living in conflict is disruptive to being able to access the internet. We've seen, many of us can relate to this, especially if you're a parent on the call, if you have young children in your lives, COVID has disrupted learning, climate disasters are disrupting learning, and these protracted crises. And what's happened is we're now seeing that over 600 million learners are impacted and are in a place where partial or complete school closures are impacting their ability to learn. And that impact is resulting in low and middle income countries having huge learning losses. So right now, UNICEF is reporting that 70% of 10-year-olds are unable to read or understand simple text. That's up from 53% right before the pandemic. So we're seeing these huge losses in learning, and we're seeing that the access to technology in learning is not being able to bridge that divide for young people. So these are the countries in which Inclusiv Education is working or has worked. And just a little bit about what these low resource settings are like. We know that internet is incredibly expensive and it's often very poor quality. Electricity is oftentimes patchy. Many people don't own a laptop, and folks are trying to get access to the internet on their phone. And that's for learning or for business, right? When children are in the classroom, sometimes those classrooms have over 100 children in one classroom. And sometimes people don't have an email address that's set up. So there are a lot of different technology barriers. Inclusiv Education is also beginning more and more work in the humanitarian space. And we're seeing a lot of additional disruptions that are happening. Obviously, one of the countries we're working in right now is Ukraine. We're seeing things like loss of power, again, loss of internet, and that inability to predict when there will be internet and when there won't be is often leading to a lot of disruptions in learning for young people. So I've been tasked with sort of setting the stage for my colleagues here, and I just wanted to kind of make sure that all of you understand the context in which we're working and the real imperative that we feel that we can bring some solutions and work together with communities. So with that, I will turn it over to Tina, who's going to start to talk us through the ILP.
Thank you, Zola. Hi, everyone. I'm really happy to join you today. And let me just move on to the next slide. So Yes, today we want to specifically talk about the ILP box that Inclusiv Education has been working with or worked on as well. I'm not sure about the background of our participants today, but the ILP box is based on the Moodle box, so published by Moodle itself, right? But we have taken the concept of the Moodle box and tried to touch it up a little bit, insert a little bit, you know, some of our ideas and what we basically did, or what the Moodle box basically did, is a single board computer that has been enhanced by using a Raspberry Pi computer. And then we have put in some improvements, like, for example, we have increased the storage using an SSD. So right now it has 2 terabytes of storage. Due to the low resource setting that Zola has mentioned earlier, you know, with constant electricity interruptions, we bought power banks that are actually strong enough to support the ILP box so that it can run throughout a class without needing any, without being plugged into electricity or like, yeah, directly plugged in. And I guess the biggest advantage of the ILP box that it doesn't need an internet connection. The way you can imagine it is basically when you want to log in into a new Wi-Fi network, right? You go to your settings in your phone or your laptop and you select that network that you want to log into. You insert your password and then you're connected to the internet. The ILP box itself also is sending out a signal. So it gives out a signal that you can connect to. So it's network basically. So it's not really connected to the internet, but you can connect to the network of the ILP box. So just as you would connect with a Wi-Fi network, you can just go to your settings on your tablet, your phone or your laptop and connect with the network of the ILP box, and then you will be connected and can access the Moodle course on your phone, laptop or tablet. I'm not the best technical person to explain the very details. We'll get to that later on when Maxwell is going to join us. He can answer some specific questions, but I hope I gave you some sort of overview of what the ILP box is used for and how it's built up a little bit. And I want to present one of our use cases in Cambodia, one of our projects where we have implemented the use of the ILP box in 7 schools. You can see it here in the image. And Save the Children has provided the schools with tablets. So the tablets were set up by the Cambodian Save the Children office with the proper apps already being pre-installed. And then the tablets were distributed into the schools. Obviously, before they could use it, we had to set up the content, right? Because the content, first of all, needed to be translated or needed to be prepared. Some of it needed to be translated, but a lot of it was already existing and provided by the Ministry of Education. A lot of it was actually videos. As I said before, we have 2 terabytes of storage, but you know how large sometimes videos can get if you do recording. So there was a lot of work involved also in resizing content and also cutting it down, because at the end, 2 terabytes isn't much if you want to provide content for grade 4 and 5. We focus on 2 grades right now, but still there's quite a lot of content, and you can't, good e-learning is not just putting up a video of a teacher teaching the class, right? So we had to work with the local team to actually produce e-learning content that is a combination of the already existing content, like videos and worksheets that they would usually also hand out in class, to upload that into Moodle and combine it with some e-learning activities that Moodle offers, right? Like the Moodle quiz or drag and drop activities, stuff like that, to make it actually more interactive. The Cambodian Save the Children office, the reason why it started out anyways was due to COVID, right? Because so many kids just couldn't attend school as it was closed. But actually, while we were working on setting this up, schools were opened again. And that's when they realized, well, we can maybe use it as a combination of blended learning. So use it in the classroom with kids working on it, on the tablets in the classrooms, and the teacher to be there to actually help out if there are any issues. And now I want to hand off to Max, who's going to talk about our project in Kenya, where we partnered with EduTab to also use the ILP Box.
So thank you very much, Tina, and everyone. Hi, everyone. My name is Maxwell Fundi. I would like to talk about how we've used the ILP Box in Kenya with Save the Children and Inclusiv Education. So Save the Children supports some of the refugee schools in one of the biggest refugee camps we have in Kenya, called Dadaab. And we have been working with different partners, in this case, Sesame Workshop, Inclusiv Education, Save the Children, to implement a pilot called Watch, Play, and Learn. And this pilot is meant to provide videos for pre-primary one and pre-primary two classes for them to be able to learn mathematics or mathematics activities and social emotional learning. So this early childhood development education in this context, we find that the children are between, say, 3 years, actually way older than that, 3, 4, 5. Some of them are up to 10. And one of the reasons why the videos were in Somali is because a lot of them cannot read or write any other language. They can only read Arabic, because it's a very Muslim community. So they've been attending madrasa, and so they saw they know Arabic and their local language, which is Somali. And how we're using ILP Box in this context is that, as Tina rightly mentioned, we have power banks, and these power banks support the use of ILP in schools because the schools do not have power at all. So the power banks support, you know, the ILP Box to be at the school while it's on, because we a lot of times need to be connected to get, you know, the content of the ILP Box. However, initially what we started doing was using the Moodle app to get all the videos downloaded offline, so that we can have the tablets in class even without needing the ILP Box. But then we met challenges along the way that related to analytics or what the kids were doing, which I'll talk about later on. And so that's why we needed, you know, to get really good power banks that can support, the ILP Box. But then technology is not enough. We provided this technology, but we also needed capacity to build the teachers to be able to use this technology effectively to promote playful learning by incorporating pre and post video activities. Remember, these are only 5 minutes videos. So, and a normal lesson is about 30 minutes long. So the teachers need to be able to incorporate, you know, pre video activities that then lead to the video, and then do post video activities. And that's part of what we did initially. And we've just been in Dadaab again last week for a refresher training. And this pilot is happening in two schools, which are supported by Save the Children. And because of influx of people, when there were all this news about all their tablets in schools, there's now technology, the attendance was too high, enrollment increased drastically, that this had to be changed to only one school. So at this point in time, we are working with one school, which has a population of about 500 students, and classes are really, really big. You have classes of ECD going up to like 100, 120, and they only have two teachers per class. And how this all works is the tablets are stored and the ILP box are stored at the Save the Children office, and they are taken to school every day. So that means that they are support people who go from Save the Children office to the school and back to deliver this technology. So some of the things we have found out, at least for last week when we were there, as I have said, due to the introduction of use of technology in these schools, there has been a huge drastic in attendance and enrollment. So for example, the initial target was about 300 learners, but now we are up to 500 learners who are using these tablets. And that's also posing a challenge in terms of, not because the tablets are being used by groups of people, but by groups of students. So the groups can get big, but sometimes they try to make them, between 4 to 5 learners. And then because this was among the first time the teachers were able to, it was about among the first time teachers were introduced to use of technology, then the teachers over time, due to the continuous capacity building that we've been doing, both virtually and face-to-face when we entered up, they've been able to use this technology. It's very simple to use. And so, because they also have smartphones and tablets and things like that, so it wasn't it was not a completely foreign thing for them. And so they've picked up that very quickly and are able now to deliver lessons, even before delivering lessons, build lesson plans that then they're able to integrate videos in their normal teaching. So yeah, those are some of the outcomes of the project so far. It's continuing again until a few more months this year. And we'll be happy also to report when we find out more outcomes. So
thank you, Maxwell. So Inclusiv Education has asked Maxwell to join today because he can best explain the use case, because he has traveled several times to the school and actually implemented the ILP boxes. And it's the most recent project where we've used the ILP box. So we thought we just have some questions for you, Max, that might be interesting for everyone to know. So basically our first question would be, what has worked well with offline learning in the Kenya project? So what has gone good, what went over well, basically? What can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so I think one of the things that worked very well was, the technology that we deployed, because this, thinking about this context that has no power and it has no electricity and all these things, and, also internet access would be quite catastrophic around those areas, then the choice of low-cost technology, ILP box, Raspberry Pis, and, normal tablets has worked really well, because these are things you can also move around. These are things that people are already used to using, for example. So that worked really well. And it would not have been successful if we did not do the teacher professional development to enable them to, one, adopt technology, and then two, be innovative and creative to teach with the technology. And one of the things that came out during our refresher last week was that they felt that, this time we're having the ILP box and the tablets is not enough. We would like to have a little bit more time to be able to prepare. And therefore, we did set up their phone so that they're able to have access to these videos at any time whenever they want, so that they can continue using their phones to prepare and make better lesson plans. And of course, because it needs people to move back and forth from the office. Having an ICT support person in the lab to go to school every day in case of any technical problems has really, really worked so well, because sometimes, maybe a tablet didn't sync properly, or maybe the tablet, the Moodle app is not open properly, or this one is hanging. But then having the ICT person, from my experience, then there are two sides of the coin. So we've had two ICT support people, and the first ICT support person was really, really good technically. You know, someone who knows a lot about technology, how technology works, he can fix things very, very quickly. But then he had no ideas or any knowledge and background on how, you know, to teach using technology. So they could not be able to support the teachers in terms of development of, for example, lesson plans, materials for teaching, or how to incorporate the videos into teaching. But then we have a second ICT support person who came in just not, you know, a few months ago. And this is a person who has a background in education, a very strong background in education, but has a lot of interest in technology. It took a while for us to be able to bring him up to speed, but I think striking that balance has been really a highlight for us, because now he's not only supporting the teachers with just bringing the technology and fixing technical issues, but he's there. He's able to support the technical and also pedagogy and teaching and incorporating of technology in teaching and learning. And then finally, another thing that has worked really well is having the support of the community. You know, in the refugee camps, you can imagine, you know, there are lots of people around the camp, that's number one, and they are formed into different groups. And so these communities, they really embrace the idea of, we now have tablets, you know, our kids will be able to learn better. And in one way or the other, they feel it's giving them an opportunity to, you know, to get good quality education. Remember, as I said, these ECD children, a lot of them don't know how to read and write in other language. They only know Arabic and Somali. So the parents also feel this is a good opportunity, and that has supported the work we've been doing with that school.
So you've already kind of answered my second question, but so you said that the teachers actually went along with the introduction of the technology quite well, right? Because if I compare it a little bit to our Cambodia project, we haven't reached that state yet, but I feel like the teacher capacity training is an upcoming stage for us. And we've had experiences in the past where actually kids, they pick up technology, phones, tablets, whatever, and they run with it. They don't have any issues navigating, you know, it's easy for them. So has your experience been that teachers actually felt good using the technology and also easy for them to learn how to use it and to use the content there?
Yeah, so I think the teachers, based on our experience, at first they were, you know, they've never done this before. And remember, these are teachers, a lot of these teachers are teachers who were born in the refugee camps. They studied there, got up to the, for example, high school level, and then they then become teachers, you know. Some of them have gone out and learned in other colleges. Others just cleared high school, and then they're just supporting their community because they had education. So we found in our experience that initially the kids were very excited with technology. And as you rightly say, we have also noticed that, you know, kids just click everywhere, trying to explore what they are able to do. And sometimes teachers may feel like, you know, these kids need to do specific things, but we also have time for the kids to explore. But the teachers have also been instrumental because they kind of own this project now. They feel it's bringing a lot more value to them. And so they are really owning the project. They are now more effective, and they are able, they feel more empowered, and that's enabled them to teach better at this point in time. even with the increased numbers, they're still okay. They are trying to subdivide the classes and things like that. So they are finding ways that they work around problems with numbers and technology to enable a better learning experience for the learners.
Okay, awesome. And now I like the metaphor you used before. It's two sides of a coin. So what would you say were the main challenges that you faced during this project?
Yeah, so I will highlight one of the big challenges we've had related to, our context. So a lot of what we needed in terms of the user analytics from Moodle were not possible using the Moodle app in the offline context. When it's completely offline, we couldn't get a lot of data that we needed. For example, being able to know, how long the videos were watched, whether the children watched the video to the end or they just watched 3 minutes, in what order, and things like that. So a lot of analytics tools that we experimented with are built for standard Moodle web. And so the fact that, these tablets could actually go to school for maybe a week without having connected back to the LP posed that challenge of being able to collect the data we needed. But still, we get some data, for example, completion activities, activity reports, completion reports, and the logs as well. But then all those are timestamped as when the syncing happens, but not when the kind of the activity happens. So that has been one of our biggest challenges, and we have been looking around to see how, we are able to, we've been exploring different ways to navigate this. For example, using XAPI or learning LRS and things like this, but it's something we're still looking into solving, and also happy to hear ideas from, the wonderful group that's on this call.
Great. Thank you so much, Maxwell. We obviously, the ILP box is not finished yet. As you've just heard from Max, there are still a few challenges that we're facing. So the ILP box is still a product in development. I'm sure there's still a lot of improvements that can be done, maybe a little bit towards our vision for the ILP box. So last year, so basically a year ago with our Cambodia project, at that point, we had the 2 terabyte internal SSD and 30 concurrent users were able to log in at the same time using one ILP box. In September, we had two another test rounds, basically, the project in Kenya and also in Cambodia, use the ILP box, and this was very important feature that specifically the Cambodia project needed and wanted, was the Kenya project, the cloud sync of user analytics and course copy. But also for the Cambodia project, the issue with the ILP box is basically that we faced is the teachers or the Save the Children office in Cambodia had to prepare all the content in advance so that it can be put onto the ILP box, and then the ILP box was brought into the school and then they would use it, right? But what happens if you want to add another course, or you're realizing there is a mistake in the course and you want to change something? That would have meant taking again the ILP box out of the school, back to the Save the Children office, and then re-uploading that course or uploading a new course. So we have actually been working with Moodle US to get the cloud syncing working. We are not there yet to report on how that works, but it has been created with the support of Moodle US, actually, and we're really excited to hopefully report on how exactly it's going to work and how well it's working. So that's basically right now in development. And for 2023, we're open to any suggestions. We want to listen to people and see what do you see still missing, basically. What use cases, or in what use cases can you see the ILP Box being implemented? And what features do you think are still missing? So we're happy for you to reach out to us. And we are going to keep working on the ILP Box and improving it and adding to it. So if you have any suggestions, please contact us. We are always happy also to collaborate and work together on this. This is a very important project for us, and it's needed in so many places. So we hope 2023 brings some bright ideas and some improvements. And so basically that's the road ahead. I want to make a quick summary and then we can get to your questions. As we said, the ILP Box is a very important project for us because it can provide those marginalized communities with access to education without relying on things like a stable internet connection or electricity. And very specifically, the teacher capacity training is an important aspect of that because it just has such a big reach and helps teacher development. And that's one of the most important things, right? To enable our teachers to use technology within the classroom or even outside the classroom and to prepare online learning so that kids who might cannot make their way to school, but maybe they have a device at home, a phone of a parent or whoever, can use it and actually also access the content that the teachers have prepared so they don't miss out. Thank you so much for listening to us today and for joining us. We are happy to now get to your questions. Zola or Richard, I don't know, are there any questions in the chat?
There's quite a few actually, which is great. Just thank you very much to the three of you for presenting on that. It's easy for people who lead the life that I live, or people that lead the lives that many of you live as well, to take all of this technology and the technology that we have and communication for granted. So it's great to great to get this sort of insight from you. So look, there are quite a lot of questions. I think I've jotted some of them down. Some of them have been responded to already. A few of the ones to start with are sort of quite technical ones. So I think if it's all right, I'll just run through these from top to bottom, and we may or may not get to all of them. So there's a question from Ian: how many users can connect to the ILP at any one time?
I believe the maximum we had were 38, Maxwell. Can you maybe confirm or deny or correct me?
Currently have a maximum of 38 based on our current test. And this is, while streaming videos, for example. But we are looking into ways of pushing that, up to, say, 50. Hopefully that's going to be possible because, again, This is a solution that's still under development. Lots of tests, lots of iterations as well.
Thank you. A question from Alex: what is the unit cost of an ILP Box? Is there an easy, clear answer on that? I guess it depends where we are, where you are.
The people that are here today don't know this, because actually originally our colleague Natalie was going to join us. She's actually the driver behind the ILP Box at Inclusiv Education. Maxwell, I know you've collaborated with Nat on providing the ILP Boxes in the Kenya project. Do you have an estimate that we can give? Otherwise, we can add that information later to our presentation or send it out and provide the actual information.
Yeah, I think it would be best to send that info, reach out later, because you know there are very many different components to this ILP box, and it's hard to quantify to say it's going to cost you $350 USD or this much. At this point,
prices are also driven by demand. We had actually issues getting Raspberry Pis at some point because they just couldn't be delivered, or very strong power banks couldn't be delivered. So the prices change depending on demand and what is available. But we're happy to get, you know, maybe a range out to you at a later point and add it to the slides.
Thank you. Yeah, look, I'll just quickly mention, so the slides from this session will make available in the course in Moodle Academy. So if you want to go back and check on those, and then I've got a lot of questions here, so we can, if you guys want to, you know, we can look at adding some of that information in. Okay, a couple of questions sort of on the, I guess, the inner workings still on the ILP box. Can you increase the storage capacity to go beyond 2 terabytes?
That's a very good question. At this point in time, we know 2 terabytes works very well with the amount of power that we are able to deliver to the box. So about more than 2 terabytes, we're still experimenting that as well. You know, we cannot say with certainty that, you know, if you have 8 terabytes, you know, this needs power as well. And, you know, when you're reading and writing things on a hard drive, then the bigger the hard drive is, the more power you need for these things. And so,
Thank you. Question on the power banks and solar. Do you have information on the sort of the sizes of the power banks and how long it can run? That's a question from Ian. Or how long it can run off the electricity grid?
Yeah, so at least for the power banks, I can give you the specifications for the output we'd need for an ILP box. And then depending on the size of the power bank, then that determines how long it's going to last. So at least a power bank that has an output of 3.1 amperes, which is higher than what you charge your phones with, that's the kind of power bank we would need for ILP box. But how long it lasts, it depends with whether your power bank is 10,000 milliamperes or 35,000 milliampere hours.
Thank you. A couple of sort of related questions. I think Tina sort of touched on this. How do you update the course software and content once the device is in the field? That's a question from Mark. And also, does the ILP box sync with the cloud, and how do you install new courses on the box? That's a question from Alex. And Tina, I think you mentioned that you're working with Moodle US
on
that sort of thing. Yep.
I see also Maxwell nodding his head. Maybe do you want to answer that question, or maybe dive a little bit deeper into how it has been done in the Kenya project, Max? So far?
I can talk about this a little bit. So before we move content onto the ILP box, we definitely set up a cloud site where all the materials were curated, and that's mirrored onto the ILP box. And so at this point in time, we are working, as rightly mentioned by Richard, that we are working with Moodle US to develop plugins and tools that enable syncing around, where if you have new content on the cloud site, as soon as the ILP box has access to, you know, internet through a cable, then that's pushed down, and everything that's could be updated offline or anything that happened offline is also pushed back to the cloud. So yeah, that's something that including updating it. So if you have courses on the cloud, can be pushed down, and if you have data or things you need to get from ILP box, that can, you know, that syncing is working at this point in time. Tina, feel free to add more info.
That's good. Thank you, Max.
So there's a question here from Mark. And again, Maxwell, I think you might have touched on this when you talked about syncing of logs. Are teachers using tracking tools like gradebook or completion status? I think that sort of vaguely maybe fits into something you mentioned earlier.
Yeah, so at least for the activities that that are set up, yes, there's a completion tracking set. But then we do not have grading because there are no proper activities for them to be graded. So what we are using is a video that is, you know, being served to the tablet, and then there are pre and post video activities that are done by the teacher in classroom within a lesson. They are not like assessments that kids have to do or things of that nature. And maybe on that question on updating the ILP box. So we have the ability to remotely log in into the ILP box if it has internet connected to it. And therefore, if we need to update to the latest version of Moodle, we just need to have it somewhere. This could be the children's office where they have internet and cables, connect the ILP box and remotely update Moodle versions.
Maybe if I can add, in the Cambodia project, we do actually we want to implement activity completion in terms of assignments. As I said, the Ministry of Education had provided a lot of documents and videos to be used. And it was quite a challenge, and we're still working on it, on how to transfer a worksheet that's basically a PDF into an online assignment, right? And if they, and then there's a challenge, do you, if they also want to use it, the content that is online, if they want to use it in a blended format, then, you know, sometimes the teacher might hand out the actual sheet for the students to complete, and sometimes they might just say, okay, please log in now and do assignments, I don't know, 1, 2, and 3. So for those online assignments, yes, we have used activity completion so that the teacher can actually see what assignments were completed and how long it took them. Or the teacher can also say, please go home and do these assignments, or, you know, tomorrow we'll continue. You have this much time to do them. So in Cambodia, we are actually playing around with activity completion. It's always a difficulty when also the project changes, right? So Cambodia, the online learning project started out due to COVID, right? Schools being closed and kids couldn't go to school at all. Now, again, circumstances have changed and the schools are open again, so we have to adjust again. I think with the ILP box and with the low resource settings, activity completion is a little bit difficult to track. So I think many times people just prefer to have open content without checking, without at least too much checking. Obviously, we like to have data, but sometimes it's easier to just, you know, open everything up and have no checking, at least in the short run or short view. That's sometimes what has to be done. So just to make content accessible,
Thank you. I'm aware of the time. I might pose one more question that we've got here, and then perhaps Zola, if you want to maybe just have a quick scan through the chat, see if there's anything else that's sort of jumping out at you that you might want to address, and then I don't think we'll be able to get to all the questions here, but let me just pose this one here while Zola picks out any more questions that she might be able to see. Bit of a broad question. What are the benefits of using Moodle in this context over some other content delivery application? Not sure who wants to field that one.
maybe I can start and then Maxwell can jump in. The advantage of Moodle is that it's open source and it's adjustable, right? And as I said before, the ILP box is based on the Moodle box, so it can be tweaked and added on. And we love working with open source products, right? It's not only an issue of low resource settings, but it's also low budget, right? So the project budget often doesn't allow for an LMS that costs this much, you know, to be maintained or to have it customized to, for example, the Save the Children branding and everything. So a lot has also to do with the cost. And we try to use as many open source projects, open source products as possible. Also, you know, Moodle has a lot to offer. All the activities that are in there, if you know how to use them, I think all of us are kind of Moodle enthusiasts, right? Just in another project, we started using Adapt, another open source authoring tool, and also the Moodle app. It's not everyone's favorite, but it is there. It works quite good. I know when I was at the Moodle Mooch, they're working on the Moodle app to make it a little bit more user-friendly, but it works. And so there are a lot of advantages that we see in Moodle. And Maxwell, is there anything you want to add that I might have missed? Good.
Good, thank you. We're getting right up to the hour. Zola, have you any other questions that you'd like to address quickly that you've seen in there?
Yeah, maybe just really quickly, Richard, there's a couple questions around sort of the education side and asking about tracking tools for grades, completion status, and Mark asked at the end here, why use an LMS at all? And I do want to just point to the very real need that many of our partners have around data collection and the need to be able to show how many students are completing and what the status is of their completion and really be able to track the learning and share that learning with their ministers. So we know that data around education is really an issue for a lot of countries to be able to get more funding for education and to be able to really meet the needs of their learners. And so as Tina mentioned, this is a really low cost, flexible solution that gives a lot of power to their learners. Tina, anything else you would add, or Maxwell? No. Okay. I'll stop there.
Sorry. No, I was trying to find the unmute button, but yeah, I think there's nothing to add right now. I did say earlier, sometimes it's easier to just not track, but obviously the ideal way would be to be able to track. And that's why the LMS is helping us. And we have very different project contexts, right? With some projects, there's no need. We're not only having projects where we use the ILP box, right? That's not our only focus. We have projects where we don't use the ILP box, and tracking is quite relevant. So it is a very important part and gives a lot of information. You just have to adapt, as Zola said, to each project and each project setting. And some things, you know, work and you can use the full potential of Moodle. And in some cases, you just don't and work with what you've got. Yeah.
All right, thank you. Look, as I mentioned earlier, we will make slides from this session available shortly. And Tina, Zola, and Maxwell, hopefully you can confirm that your contact details might be in there somewhere. So anyone who wants to reach out, and yep, I'm seeing nodding heads, that's good. So feel free to reach out with any more questions. That is almost it. This is, this has been a great session. Thank you so much to the three of you for presenting and sharing. Thanks to all of you for being here. And you know, we've had some great discussion as well. I'm just going to take about another minute and a half, if that, just to wrap things up. So just let me share my screen very, very, very quickly. So yeah, look, if you have enjoyed this session, we'd love you to consider getting involved further and helping us grow by contributing to the development of Moodle Academy. You can do this by visiting our Get Involved course, which you'll find on the front page of the Moodle Academy site. You can suggest ideas for new webinars and courses, and you can vote on ideas that have been suggested by others already. We're always on the lookout for community members to help present webinars, and today has been a fantastic example of that, and also to co-create short online courses. And we'd love for your help making Moodle Academy more inclusive. So if you're able to, please jump into our Translate Moodle Academy course and get started with helping us translate our courses and webinars into other languages. And of course, you know, please help spread the word about Moodle Academy by telling your colleagues about the courses we offer and the events that we run. When you complete our courses, you earn badges, so you can build up a nice collection of those to stick on your digital wall or wherever you put those. Educators might like to think about getting involved with the Moodle Educator Certificate. You can take the Are You Ready for the MEC quiz, and one of our certified service providers will support you through the certification process. So that is it. Thank you again so much to the three of you. Thank you to everyone else for joining us, and hopefully you found this useful. And yeah, look, we hope to see you around in Moodle Academy courses and in our upcoming webinars soon. So thank you again, and we'll see you soon.